time having arrived, I call this meeting of the Brockton School Committee to
order and ask you to please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Could I ask everyone to please remain standing? The superintendent is going to ask for a moment of silence.
This past week, we lost a dear member of our Brockton Public School family. This is actually a woman, Kathy Driscoll Kesnowski. And Kathy is somebody I actually went to high school with. She was a year older than me. We again connected once we started to teach in Brockton. She became an administrator at then the Belmont Street School. Wonderful person, loved kids, you know, great sense of humor, and is gone from us much too young. And I would ask that we have a moment of silence, please.
Thank you. Everyone be seated. Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome. Our first order of business is the hearing of visitors. Hearing of visitors is an opportunity for members of the public to address myself, the superintendent, and members of the school committee. Mr. Confrey, how do you know you're first on the list?
That's
okay.
I was also first one at the other.
There we go. So let me just, for those that aren't usually at our meetings, let me remind everyone what the guidelines are for hearing of visitors. Mr. Confrey, you have up to 3 minutes. All matters are taken under advisement by the school committee and the superintendent. And the floor is yours.
My name is Gerald Confrey. My daughter goes to Brockton High School. She's a senior, Berriana. I'm disappointed by the meeting that we just had. I thought important questions regarding charter schools did not come up, did not get answered. We go back to 1993 for charter schools, the Ed Reform Act. When you look at it, we had, in that time, they were supposed to come out and they were supposed to be giving, sharing information. They were supposed to be doing things to innovate curriculum. All of those things that were supposed to be part of the Ed Reform Act never happened. There's been no sharing. We're talking 23 years later. And if you take $400 million, you multiply it times 10 years, that's $4 billion. You do it times 20 years, you're talking $8 billion. And if you round it off to $10 billion for 23 years, you spent $10 billion educating 5% of the population with public money, using public money to go to schools that are for profit. And no one knows where that money has gone. No one knows what the profit is. There is no disclosure to the public about where that $10 billion has gone. And people should be asking that. People should be asking that. That's public money going to a corporation or a business to make a profit. And that money needs to go back to the public coffers. It needs to go back to public schools. And that's what I would like to have said at the other meeting, and I did get to say it here. Even though I'm still a little mad, I got to say it. Thank you.
Just under 3 minutes, too. Yeah, right on. At this time, we'll ask the school committee to consider our consent agenda. The consent agenda is a block of items of relatively routine business before the school committee that is considered as one for the purposes of keeping the meeting moving along. However, any individual member of the school committee may request that any specific item be removed from the consent agenda for individual consideration. So at this time, I'll ask if any members of the committee would like to remove any items from tonight's consent agenda. Okay, seeing none, I'll entertain a motion on the consent agenda.
Motion to approve.
I'll get you in just a moment, ma'am. Motion's been made. Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion's been made and properly seconded to approve the consent agenda in its entirety. All in favor? Opposed? Approved. Ma'am, we don't take questions from the audience, but I'll entertain one very short one because you look like you're trying to get my attention. Yeah, so for hearing of visitors, you have to sign in by the time the meeting is started. Once the meeting is started, it's too late. I apologize, but we invite you to come back to a future meeting. Okay? Okay?
October 4th.
Yep.
October 4th.
Okay, at this point, we have a couple presentations to do. I will turn the floor over to the superintendent for her report on teaching and learning.
The first group that I'd like to invite down are Cradles to Crayons. Hi. Could you please sit there? We are very, very pleased this evening to have Cradles to Crayons organization. It's an organization that I have actually known for many, many years, having been a school adjustment counselor in the district. And many times, and I'm talking years ago, being able to reach out to support a family, to support a need in a particular school, and they came through truly with flying colors. This past year, we had school committee member Joyce Azak come to us just about a couple of weeks before school was beginning, and she was very excited about a gift of 1,000 backpacks coming into the city. No, not soon after that, I get another call from school committee member Azak telling me that had increased to 2,000 backpacks coming in for our elementary schools, our middle schools, and certainly, you know, we all know that when school starts, everybody wants new things. They want those shiny new school supplies, and they want to have that new backpack to fit in like every other kid for a new start for the year. So we can't thank Cradles to Crayons enough. I had the opportunity the other night to call into the Dan Ray Show, and I was very, very pleased, you know, to be able to tell him certainly what it means to kids. Many times we have a number of homeless children that live in the city, you know, and they could be in a home and the next day someplace else. Sometimes their belongings are left behind. So this allows our staff to be able to support so many youngsters in our district, and we can't thank you enough. And I'd love you to share a little bit about Cradles to Crayons, please.
Sure. As you mentioned, my name is Kylie, and I'm from Cradles to Crayons, and our organization really focuses on providing essential items like clothing, shoes, footwear, backpacks, school supplies, warm winter coats, hats, and gloves to kids who are in need. So this year, we were able and happy to have an increase in the backpacks we were able to provide, and so one of the first places that we had on our map to give a call was Brockton Public Schools. So we're really excited to work with Joyce to make sure that we could get those 2,000 backpacks into the hands of the students of the Brockton Public Schools. We look forward to having further conversations about how our organization can really partner, not only with Brockton Public Schools, but the city itself, to be a support for the folks living here. And to be able to provide those really key essential items and get them into the hands of the families who need them. So we appreciate working with you guys and look forward to working with you even more.
Well, we're very pleased that you want to continue to have dialogue with us, because you can imagine the need is very great. We have some of our schools where the poverty level is over 96%. So this is a welcome to those teachers that are out there, to those families that need support. And, you know, again, we are always looking for businesses, for nonprofits to join us and to really help make the load a little lighter. So we have a certificate we'd like to give you. Joyce, could you come join us, please? Yes, oh yes. Joyce unloaded the truck when it came for all the backpacks, brought her family members. It was quite an operation. Please join me in congratulating her. I will have to tell you, I got a surprise, those of you that listen to Dan Ray on WBZ, because when I called in, and I always pride myself having been here for so many years and knowing a lot of the teachers and staff, and Dan Ray said to me, you're the superintendent in Brockton, you must know my nephew at the high school, he's a guidance counselor, David Ray. and I did not have a clue. So I have reached out to David Ray. I am thrilled to finally connect with him, hopefully. And again, just a great opportunity to thank you for the work you do.
Just for the record, Superintendent, I know Dave.
Of course you do, Mr. Mayor.
Just to coach girls basketball.
Good job. See what a team?
Yes, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, and another, I'd like to actually invite Deputy Superintendent Thomas, Dr. Murray. And we're talking about another donation. And this is a really, you know, I listen to sports radio. Those of you that know me know I stay tuned. And I hear about Northeast Electrical all the time. And they talk about, you know, lighting up fields and all of these wonderful things. And I was so excited when Brockton was finally the winner. So could you please share with us about Northeast Electrical?
Yes, we want to thank Northeast Electrical President Don Block, and we have Nate Pedro here, who Nate is the Energies Manager Solution. Is that, what's your title? I'm sorry, it's Energy Solutions Manager. So Nate is a actually proud alumni of West Middle School and of Brockton High School, so we're glad to have him here. So I'll let Dr. Murray fill you in, but this is a $50,000 grant. I want to thank Dr. Murray. I want to thank Karen Watts. I want to thank Ken Thompson for their hard work, the facilities director, on putting this grant together and sending it over to Northeast Electrical. And I'll let Dr. Murray fill you in on the work that happened at West Middle School.
Well, we were very fortunate. We were approached last spring when the grant was awarded. For many of you who have attended events in our auditorium, you may have noticed that the lights are about as old as the school, and they immediately recognized an opportunity to change our lighting, not only in our auditorium, but then as we walk the building, they were very conscious about ways to enhance the environment, but also save on energy costs. And they changed all the lighting in our auditorium. It's incredibly different. We have a lot of events in there, so that's something that the entire community obviously is going to get to enjoy. And if anybody has an opportunity, they should come by and actually walk the building. I don't have my sunglasses on because I'm not there right now, but the lighting is incredible. They did a fantastic job. The school is very, very well lit. The kids noticed the first day that the school was as bright and as clean as it's ever been. So we're very, very grateful. They did the job in a very timely fashion. The crew was very professional, and we are very, very grateful, the students, their parents, and our staff, for what they provided for us this year. So thanks again to your crew and to everyone involved with the grant. Thank you.
Could you join us, Dr. Murray? Sorry, I have my glasses on my head. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. The commercials are great. And let me switch to some really good news. I was notified in August, and also this administrator in Brockton was also notified, and I'd like to invite Jonathan Shapiro to please come up. So I'm going to read you this letter. The Massachusetts Biotechnology Education Foundation, Mass BioEd, has established a new program, Champions for Biotechnology Education, to recognize the unsung heroes behind excellent life sciences education. Beginning in 2016, this annual awards program will recognize the achievements of an organization, a supporter, and an educator in their efforts to support biotechnology-related educational programming in Massachusetts public schools. So they were pleased, and we are pleased to present to you Jonathan Shapiro as the 2016 Champion for Biotechnology Educators Award. Congratulations, Jonathan. Jonathan, can you share some thoughts, please?
Yeah, thank you so much, and also thank you so much to Mass BioEd for this opportunity.
I think it's important to note that while my name's on that, this is really the recognition of an entire program's work. All the teachers, the administrators, the support staff, it's made all that great work and all the opportunities that the students have are made possible by so many people. So I want to express my appreciation to all of them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. Oh, sure. Go ahead.
I just, to interrupt just 1 second, I noticed that we do have several city officials joining us for tonight's meeting, so I just want to make sure we recognize them. Ward 5 City Council Ann Beauregard is here. City Council at Large Shayna Barnes is with us. And our good friend and former City Council at Large Jay Stewart is here with us tonight. So we just want to acknowledge that those elected officials are here with us tonight for the commissioner's visit.
Thank you. So in the report of learning and teaching, I want to talk about the opening of kindergarten, probably the happiest day that we have in the Brockton Public Schools. At that point, we have our students 1 through 12 back in, usually a week ahead of time. So last Thursday, the weather was wonderful, the buses rolled. It is interesting when you drive around the city on that day and to look at these very, very little people. And my favorite part, and all of you will join me, when you know, when those buses pull in, you can barely see those heads over the windows. And certainly when they leave later in June, you can well see that these children have grown. If we're looking at our numbers, last year at this time, we had 1,371 kindergartners registered in Brockton. This year, our number is 1,368. Look how close that is. So we are not a district that certainly demographically are losing those students. We continue to certainly stabilize. We had a number of years where we were growing by 100 and 200 students in our kindergarten level, hence opening up of the Barrett Russell Kindergarten Center back in September of 2013, 3 years ago. So we're pretty much stabilizing. We also have about 232 students that entered our Gilmore preschool. So as I always do, I invite you to get out into the schools. I had an opportunity to actually get over to a few of the schools on opening day, and the kids were already getting into their routines, the same things we really told you about the opening of school. It's amazing when you go to visit an hour or two after the bell has rung, the kids are already settled in and they're all pros at it. So again, I want to tell parents out there that if you do have your five-year-old at home, you know, please make sure that you're out there registering those students for kindergarten as classes have begun. Any questions? Okay. I also want to make a comment that I know a number of you were out there, and this was very new to me, celebrating International Dot Day. So around the district, and this was also last Thursday, I had the opportunity to go to the Huntington Elementary School. I was invited by our new principal, Mary Beth O'Brien, was given the dot book to read ahead of time. It wasn't difficult reading, but the message was really interesting. And if you haven't had an opportunity to read the dot book, and I got to read it to our fifth graders at the Huntington, it talks about a student that doesn't have confidence in their artistic ability. Many of us can probably relate. And there's a teacher that tells the student to just go ahead and put something, a mark on the paper. And the student tries very hard, and the student is frustrated, and the student places a dot on the so-called canvas, the piece of paper. And what that dot turns into is much more than artistic value. It is truly a student having the opportunity with a teacher that believes in the student and the opportunity to express themselves, to be creative, and to really do anything that you want to do. And I loved the questions that the fifth graders asked of me when we talked about the dot and things that they do well, things that they're afraid of trying, and everybody committed to going out there and finding that inner self in you and really giving it your all. So I want to thank all of the schools in the district that celebrated, if any of you didn't know, International Dot Day. And now I'd like to invite the Commissioner of Education, Mitchell Chester, to come up and join me. This is going to be, again, another opportunity to kind of, those of you that were with us previously, we had the Commissioner in the audience and sharing with us the work going on and the support that we get from the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. And I believe, again, we're going to present to the school committee and open up to your questions. Thank you. Okay, and if, can we have the PowerPoint?
Do we have to do something here?
There we are.
Okay.
Thank you, Commissioner.
That is the extent of my technological knowledge, so.
I'm in trouble.
You want me to start out that?
Please,
well, first of all, thank you for the opportunity to be here with you. I know that some of you were at the public session earlier today. Appreciate your vice chair's moderation of that session. What a tremendous turnout. I don't see that very often in very many communities. So I just want to applaud the work that you're doing to engage parents, the Kids Count initiative, what your superintendent is doing. And I'll say more about that later, but Brockton is a district that I've watched very closely over my tenure. I've made the comment that Brockton High School is the very first high school, very first school that I visited in Massachusetts when I became commissioner. Literally my first week on the job, I came to Brockton, I visited the district, and I visited the high school. So it's a real pleasure to be here. I'm going to try to go relatively quickly because I think some of you have seen some of the material. There will be an area that I'm going to hone in on that I did not get as specific about during the public session. So for those of you who were there earlier, there is some new material in this. And I'm going to encourage Superintendent Smith to add and bring the Brockton perspective and the Brockton implication to the slides that I'm going to show you. But I'm going to talk a little bit about performance of Massachusetts students. I'm going to talk about the education reform and how that's played forward since 1993. Talk a little bit about spending, progress that's been made. Talk a little bit about what the state education agency's priority areas are, and in particular going to focus on the steps we're taking to make sure that the learning expectations for students in Massachusetts are up to date, reflect what it takes to have opportunities to be successful in today's world, as well as to align our statewide assessment system to that as well. I see you're getting paper copies of that, so of the presentation, so that's great. One of the things that's surprised me, and it's been driven home in the last year, is that there is not a good appreciation in the Commonwealth for how well the Commonwealth's public education system has done, elementary and secondary education. And in fact, over the last decade, our students participate in a national testing program in grade 4 and 8, tested in both reading and math, that's given in all 50 states. And our students are second to none among the 50 states. And likewise, our students have participated on several international assessments that are given across the globe. In 2011, they participated in an assessment of science and math for eighth graders. In 2012, an assessment of reading, of science, of math for 15-year-olds. And if Massachusetts was a country, we would have literally been second in the world in science, fifth in math on the first test, eighth grade. We would have been fourth in the world in reading, seventh in the world in science, and 10th in the world in math on the 15-year-old, the test of 15-year-olds. And you know, that success is reflected in the work that's happened in Brockton and in the other school districts in the Commonwealth. And I have no illusions or delusions about where that success comes from. It comes from outstanding district leaders like Kathleen Smith. It comes from outstanding teachers, outstanding parents and students. And I want to publicly announce, and I asked our teachers at the public session to stand to acknowledge them. And I want to personally acknowledge Kimberly Gibson. I'm not sure if Kimberly's in the room. Kimberly is here. I want to publicly applaud you for, as president of the Brockton Education Association, for your spirit of collaboration to support Brockton students. The Brockton's got a very much a cornerstone place in the history of education reform in Massachusetts. That reform was launched with a omnibus legislation in 1993. It's sometimes referred to as the Grand Bargain. The official title of that legislation was the Massachusetts Education Reform Act, MERA, MERA it's sometimes referred to, and it was prompted in part by a lawsuit. And the plaintiff in that lawsuit, it was a lawsuit about spending, making the case that the Commonwealth was failing in its responsibility to the school districts of Massachusetts in terms of funding school districts equitably. And that lawsuit became known as the McDuffie case. And it's named after Jamie McDuffie, now Jamie Milnemoe, who was the lead plaintiff at the time. She was a Brockton public school student, a high school student. She eventually became a classroom teacher here in Brockton and is now an instructional resource specialist at the Kennedy Elementary School, a school that became a level one school in part because of her support.
Yes, so last year we were very pleased. It's, you know, one of our elementary school. It has a bilingual population. We have a large Haitian population that are there to begin their education. You know, certainly it is part of the success story in Brockton. And we have instructional resource specialists. And I know, Commissioner, when you came to visit the Arnone School, I want to say 2 years ago, one of the things you heard the teachers talk to you about in Brockton, and it was very much of their voices, about the elementary literacy specialist, the instructional resource specialist, working and coaching and bringing best practices, right, which Jamie is a part of, and we're very pleased that that has become a level one school.
So that's really neat. I mean, she had a hand in sort of launching this era of reform more than 20 years ago as a student, and is now a cornerstone of the efforts in Brockton to provide everybody with a strong education. But really, I think about five key pieces of that grand bargain. The state agreed to put much more money into education and to fund it in a progressive formula. And I'll show you some data in another slide or two about what I mean by progressive. But in return, the state said, we need to aim high in terms of the expectations for what students learn, what we call learning standards. Sometimes you'll hear them referred to as frameworks, curriculum frameworks. We had to have high quality assessments aligned to those standards to measure the level at which students were in fact achieving and the progress that districts are making toward meeting those standards. School choice was a part of that grand bargain, including charter schools, and vocational technical schools were already on the scene. And then ultimately accountability for results. So that's what's known as the grand bargain. More money in return for expectations for delivering a stronger and stronger education year after year to the children of the Commonwealth. I'm going to talk a little bit about the funding and bring it specifically to Brockton. So this is the part of the state budget that funds K-12 education, elementary and secondary education. In this year's budget, it's over $5 billion out of a budget of just over $30 billion. The biggest single component of the state budget is healthcare, mass health and healthcare and human services. This is one of the biggest expenditures in the state budget. Represents about one out of every $6 that the state raises goes into K-12 education. And here's how it's spent. 99% of it goes out to school districts. The biggest chunk through the local aid formula, what you have heard of referenced as Chapter 70, the foundation formula. There's a big piece around special ed reimbursement. There's a big piece that represents a variety of different grants that go to districts. And then the core services, our assessment program, our licensure, as well as the administration of the state system, the Department of Ed, is about 1%, 1.1% of that total budget. I mentioned to you that the state formula was rewritten with that 93 legislation. So let me show you first what's happened to state funding for Brockton specifically over the last 9 years. And one of the pieces, so each bar represents different components. These are state funds. They don't represent the local or the federal funds that are spent in Brockton. I'm going to show you another slide that looks at that. But the biggest piece of this is the Chapter 70 school aid, what we call the foundation funding formula. Then there's components that are related to entitlement, competitive grants, transportation. Brockton gets money from charter school reimbursements. Brockton gets money from Circuit Breaker, which is the special ed fund. Brockton gets money from State Fiscal Stabilization Fund. What happened over this period is this is the period of the Great Recession in the United States and in Massachusetts. And to the credit of leadership in this state, because I don't decide what gets spent on education. The legislature and the governor collectively decide that. And through this terrific downturn that we had, this recession, the leadership in this state, Governor Patrick at the time, and the legislature, continued to put money into education, more money each year in each successive year. This is what's happened to Brockton's share of that state funding over that time. It's a 34% increase since 2008. And in fact, if you went back to 2008 and you just looked at the Chapter 70 aid, the basic foundation aid, that's actually up around 39% was my calculation, almost 40% during that time period. These are the state dollars that come to Brockton. Now, the total Brockton budget is about $229 million. Did I get this right?
That's correct.
And you can see that the state dollars account for 77% of the funds. The other 23% are raised from local revenue, local taxation and revenue, as well as their federal grants that Brockton gets as well. I mentioned earlier that the state funding formula is a progressive formula. What that means is we look at each and every community in the Commonwealth, and we look at a formula for ability of that community to raise dollars locally, kind of a local wealth factor. And that's a combination of property values, the ability a community has to raise taxes from property taxes, and income, looking at the income of the citizens. And based on that, we figure out what proportion of the school district budget should come from state dollars, what proportion should be raised locally. At the just to give you an example of the extremes that formula represents, for a high wealth community, they will receive as little as 15% of their budget from the state. For the lowest wealth communities in the state, and that would, the two lowest wealth communities in the state are Lawrence and Holyoke, they are receiving upwards of 90-95% of their budget from the state based on the calculation of the ability to raise money, property values in those communities, and incomes in those communities.
Commissioner, can I jump in for
sure,
a minute?
Sure.
One thing I want to say here, and I know there will be a lot of questions when we're finished, you know, about funding. This has been the first time in a long time, because we are a struggling city, where the mayor met full foundation of the budget. I want to thank Mayor Carpenter. We worked really hard with all our elected officials this past budget season. And we are a city that continues, I want you to hear from us, that we continue to look for growth. We're looking for businesses. We're looking to make sure that we can support our youngsters. And while we're appreciative when you look at the amount of money that, you know, we've put out there, you know, from the state, whether it's grants, whether it's the Chapter 70 funding, you know, it still continues to fall short when we look at wealthy communities, as you mentioned, who meet their foundation and many times go above and beyond that, you know, 200%. Some communities, I looked at the numbers, 300. So we are struggling, but it's not a community that isn't looked to meet foundation and also looking to bring businesses in and growth in the city so we can continue to support. So when you see a proud city here, that's what we're trying to do.
Yeah, absolutely. And sometimes I remind school committees that city council, your mayor and city council, have tough decisions to make, right? There's not enough money to spend on everything they wish they could spend on, and they've got to ensure all kinds of city services are robust. And so there's always tough decisions to be made. Let me show you a couple of slides showing you some of the statewide progress. We've been watching graduation rates improve year after year. in the state, and these represent real kids. So this change from 2006 to 2015 represents 7,000 fewer youngsters leaving the system without graduating. Those are real kids whose life chances are enhanced by at least having a high school diploma in hand, which arguably is a minimum credential in today's world. We also track, is everybody succeeding or are only some kids succeeding? Yeah, I'm going to show you two different slides. This looks at the progress of African American, Hispanic, and white students in 10th grade, on the left in literacy, on the right in mathematics. And what's really neat about this is that every group has made progress. The groups that started the furthest behind have made some of the strongest progress. The challenge here is that there remain major achievement gaps, and we continue to work on them, and I know that Brockton continues to work on them.
And Commissioner, in looking at these slides, when we talk about Brockton, it's interesting. When we look at our John and Abigail Adams scholarship winners, yep. Some years yep. There have been over 300. I think this year was about 294. They look like the diversity of our community.
Terrific.
They look like our kids. Yep. Our top students many times in our classes, our minority students, again, National Honor Society, you know, taking, as you mentioned, the AP classes. So, you know, we certainly are working and narrowing this achievement gap.
Yeah, and I'll show some data on that as well. This is the same graph, but this is low-income, non-low-income students in this case. And again, you can see that students from low-income backgrounds who often have, who still trail their non-low-income counterparts, nonetheless have made substantial progress over these last 15 or so years. Here's some slides on Brockton. And your graduation rate is moving in the right direction. You had a bit of a peak in 2008 that you fell off of, but from 2010 on, it's been a clear upward trend in terms of the graduation rate. And these are the percentage of students who are graduating within 4 years of when they start high school. So there are some students who don't finish within 4 years, who stick with it, and they do get a diploma in 5 years, some in 6 years. These are the four-year graduation rates. And at the same time, you've put a big cut into the dropout rate. So the dropout rate is substantially lower than it was 10 years back, 7, 8, 9 years back.
So Commissioner, we've been able to develop in Brockton, and sometimes this is grant dependent as we watch grants dry up. You know, the high-risk youth grant.
Yep.
There was a mass grad grants. All yep. of this we put into right. our pathway programs.
Yep.
So we have 4,200 students here at Brockton High School. Not everybody makes it here. Some kids need a different setting. We have an evening setting for over-aged, under-credited students
yep.
For our bilingual youngsters.
Yeah, some of those classes as I came
I'm
up
I'm sure yep. you did. Yep. That was Edison yep. Academy. We just yep. graduated over 200 this past summer. The mayor and I were there in July. So we continue to develop these pathways. So when we're looking at those grants, it is critical that they remain in place so we can educate those students. We have collaborations with Massasoit, with Bridgewater State, yep. with Southeastern Regional,
yep.
and those are things that we continue to look at.
That's terrific. And one more Brockton-specific slide, and Superintendent alluded to this earlier. So. One of the things that we're interested in is the degree to which our high schools across the state are providing students with an opportunity to take challenging coursework. Coursework that colleges will recognize is really an indication of whether students are ready for college-level work. And one of the pieces that we watch are advanced placement courses that are offered through the College Board. And if you go back again a decade, just over 130, 140 students in Brockton High School were taking those courses, which represents the degree to which they were available to them. And the climb has just been spectacular from 2012 on, as you've just multiplied, more than doubled, the number of students who are taking AP courses and AP tests. And in fact, the College Board has an honor roll called the Gaston Caperton Opportunity Honor Roll. And in 2015, Brockton High School is one of 13 districts in the state, more than one of 130 across the whole nation, that were honored for expanding opportunity and access to all students, including students who traditionally have been underrepresented in advanced placement courses. And can I toot your horn a little bit here?
Sure.
The U.S. News and World Report, sometimes we're least aware of how we're viewed. U.S. News and World Report recognized Brockton High School as one of the nation's best high schools for six times since 2009. The International Center for Leadership and Education named Brockton High School a model school since 2003. So a lot of folks watch the education you're providing in Brockton to a very diverse community and a very diverse group of students, and cite Brockton High School and Brockton School District as a district that stands out in a positive way from what's seen in, unfortunately, in most other high schools that serve as diverse a population as you do. So I'm going to finish by just focusing a little bit on where the state is going and how we're going there. And I would encourage you, Superintendent, yep, to talk about Brockton's role here, because I know you've been very tuned into this. So I'm going to focus on the standards, curriculum, instruction, and assessment. So that's one of our five focus areas. I'm not going to talk much about educator development, but this is an area that we're focused on. We have a focus on district and school turnaround. I'm not going to cover that unless you want to go there in the questions. We have a priority around technology and data to support teaching and learning, and we have a priority around social, emotional, and health needs of students and families. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the last four. I am going to focus primarily on the first one, because we're in a very active period of reassessing and refining our learning expectations and building a next generation assessment to be aligned to that refinement. So we are upgrading our academic, we call them standards, we call them frameworks. These are the learning expectations, grade by grade. We are in the process of refining the literacy and the math. We have finished refining the science, technology, and engineering. We will start on the history and social science in January, probably. And at the same time, we're building the next generation MCAS. MCAS has been around for 20 years now without being changed. It's largely the same assessment that was given 20 years ago. It's a good assessment, but it needs to be upgraded. And so we're in the process of doing that and upgrading that in a way that it aligns to the refined academic standards. Brockton has been very active, and you have had educators in the district who have been very active to this initiative. And you can trace this back to 2010, when we last upgraded our standards and started to think about a new testing program. And I don't know if they're in the room or not, Superintendent, but two educators from Brockton in particular, Dr. Heather Ronan, who's coordinator of math and science for K-5, and Eileen McQuaid, who's the coordinator of English Language Arts for grades 6 through 12, have both been very active participants with the state. We rely a lot on teachers, administrators, to help us figure out where we should be going and how we should get there.
And Commissioner, yeah, we recently did a presentation, and when I say recently, I'm talking probably last spring, so we continue to keep our school community informed of the shifts and the changes, and there were a lot of questions, just a couple of months ago with the school committee.
Got it. I can tell you, your superintendent is very diligent about figuring out what's out there, whether the state's doing it or someone else is doing it, that we should be paying attention to, and we should be bringing back to Brockton to strengthen what we're doing. So, this slide is designed to show you that the state testing program serves multiple purposes. It informs curriculum improvements district by district. It helps the state figure out the kind of progress that schools are making and districts are making. It provides parents and teachers with an indicator of individual student progress, and it does serve as a graduation requirement as well. As well as data on how students are doing becomes one of many factors that are part of educator evaluations. So why are we aligning our standards? I talked a little bit about this in the earlier session. One of the things we realize is that our high school assessment, the 10th grade assessment, is not giving parents and students or educators very reliable signals about whether students are on track to be prepared for what colleges and employers expect. So how do we know this? When we watch our graduates, so these are the students who are successful on the MCAS and who meet all of the Brockton or any district's curriculum requirements, who then attend Massachusetts public colleges, we see that more than a third in any given year, sometimes as much as 40%, are being placed into remedial courses in college, what's sometimes called developmental courses. They're courses that they're not getting credit toward a diploma in, and they're getting remediated in subjects that they really should have learned in high school if they were going to be ready for college level work. So we want our next generation assessment system to give parents, educators, students with accurate information, reliable information about is my child on track going from fourth to fifth grade, from eighth grade to high school, and ultimately in high school, is my child ready for what the world after high school is going to expect of him or her. I know that Brockton's been an early adopter in terms of field testing and pilot in the park. I don't know if you want to say something
about
that. Yeah.
One of the things that we talk about, you know, we were an early adopter, and many of you know there was an opportunity for the so-called hold harmless. But no district is really able to do that because you have to continue to look at the accountability measures, you know, to make sure with sharing with parents the progress of students. But it was more, Commissioner, about making sure that we were at the forefront, you know, looking at technology. We had a plan those first couple of years, and I thank you, I'm not sure if you'll remember, but the urban districts back then asked you, and that's when I said you were a good listener, there was concern about 18 sites were chosen during the first year to do the pilot testing. And we weren't able to do that. We were able as a district, and you allowed us to choose a couple of schools where we could focus our efforts with our administrative staff, implementing our technology, making sure we were working with teachers on that instructional shift, and that, excuse me, made a difference as a district for us to kind of test drive park. We've continued to grow as a district, bringing on whole schools where, again, we infuse technology, we bring in instruction, where we have a long way to go. There are lots of things that we know we want to do, and of course money becomes a concern, but that was our reason for early adopting PARC, making sure that our district, our students had an opportunity to test drive and our teachers had an opportunity to see, and the rollout wasn't easy. It has become much easier as time has gone on.
I mean, this to me is emblematic of your superintendent's commitment to making sure that you guys, that Brockton is paying attention to where things are going and providing students with a kind of cutting edge opportunity. The PARC test that the superintendent referred to was sort of our stepping stone to our next generation assessment. And districts had a choice of whether to administer that or stick with the old test. And most districts at this point have gone with the new test, and Brockton was out in front on that. So the superintendent mentioned this test drive. So we spent 2 years looking at a test that was developed by Massachusetts along with a dozen other states. We ultimately decided last fall that we wanted to build off of this new assessment, but we wanted it to be customized for Massachusetts so that Massachusetts educators remained in control of what the final product looked like for our next generation MCAS. We had the 2 year test drive. This gives you some of the figures on how many students took PARC, how many took MCAS, how many took it on computer versus paper and pencil. And this is the timeline, so we're very much on track. The board took the vote in November. We have a contract in place. We're in the process of developing the new assessments. And this spring, all the students in grades 3 to 8 will be taking our next generation MCAS for the first time. 10th grade will continue to use the legacy 10th grade test, the existing 10th grade test, at least through the class of 2019, possibly through the class of 2020. We have a variety of work groups, committees that are advising us on this. These are made up of Massachusetts educators, Massachusetts administrators, curriculum developers, curriculum coordinators. These are, we rely very heavily on our teachers and administrators to give us the input for, are we going in the right direction? Are we making the right decisions? And you can see the wide number of advisory committees that we've convened.
And Commissioner, yep. We do have a number of our Brockton Public School administrators, teachers serving on a number of those committees. I know Dr. Ethan Cancel is serving on the School and District Accountability. I'm not sure if I'm missing anybody else, but, you know, again, we try to make sure that our, you know, educators are part of the work groups and committees.
No, that's great. And this is really the final slide. So those work groups are bringing recommendations to me, to our department, and to the State Board of Education, and we will finalize these and have a new test in place in grades 3 through 8 in this coming spring of 2017. Just to clarify and fine-tune that will be for literacy and for math, English language arts and math. Our science testing program will be a year behind that in terms of building the next generation. So those are my prepared comments, and I'd be happy to respond to any questions that you might have.
Commissioner, welcome again to Brockton. We certainly know that you are well aware of the good work that we have in our district, and you were even at the Brookfield School with the breakfast in a backpack, the breakfast program in the morning, so you saw the rollout of that. One thing that you certainly, I think, heard loud and clear is that Brocktonians feel very strongly about this school district. It's a school system that is so many things to so many students and so many parents. And I think the community voiced certainly loudly a concern about what they view as a chipping away of resources that are so critical to the success in Brockton. Like I mentioned to you earlier, we know how to educate children in Brockton. We know how to make children succeed. And the longer students are in the Brockton Public Schools, the better they do. The only thing naturally is we've had some tough budgets this last few years. We've had some very tough budgets, and this year, you know, this committee and this administration and city, with the support of the mayor, unfortunately had to let close to 30 teachers go. And those teachers are critical, especially with regard to class sizes. So we know, we were hoping going into this year's budget that the governor was going to adopt some of the recommendations with regard to the Chapter 70 review committee for poverty students of poverty levels, at certain poverty levels, ELL students. Special ed students. So we were holding hope that we might be able to benefit from some of those recommendations. So the question basically is, you know, where do you see things are at with regard to that? You know, do you think that there's going to be some movement? Because a district like Brockton, a community like Brockton, you know, where we appreciate the increase in money that we saw on the scale above, but it doesn't take into account the special cohorts that we have here in Brockton. Every year, we're getting students with issues that are heartbreaking, you know, to our community, that are coming from families and coming from places that no one wishes they were there. But we are dealing with that, and we welcome these kids. We love these kids, but, you know, these types of issues, you know, take more money than the average community in order to address them. So if you could just talk to us about where the Chapter 70 committee
review committee is with regard to those types of issues that they themselves identified as issues to be addressed.
Through the chairman,
yes,
Mr.
Sir.
Mayor. So the committee that's being referenced is, was a commission that the legislature set up, a commission to study the foundation budget formula, Chapter 70 formula. And the commission, there are a number of pieces to the recommendations. Probably the two cornerstone pieces that came out of it were looking at how the formula was set up initially and looking at where the formula still was relevant as well as where it had fallen off. And the two places where that were identified where it has fallen off are in terms of the growth of healthcare costs that school districts assume and special education costs. Those two areas were identified as if there's any place where the foundation formula could use an adjustment from where it is now, those are the two places. In addition, the commission identified a number of other recommendations on areas that they would like more investment in. The state budget, we have a situation where revenues are not keeping up with as anticipated. It's a bit confounding. The heading into the spring, we're a state that looks like it's in a recovery. Like we're coming out of the recession, like the economy is expanding. The budget for this year, the year that we're in, was built on projections from that expansion. So what the state does is they have a panel of economists and they project, and they projected 4.3% growth. I'm not sure I have that exactly right for this coming year, and they built a budget based on that. Along came April, May, and June, the last 3 years of the last budget cycle, and revenue started falling off of projections. And it's continued to fall off through July and August. And so it's in that context, and I'll add one other piece to it. There are parts of the state budget that are growing much more rapidly than others. Healthcare is the biggest. Health and Human Services, healthcare. There are structural pieces of the state budget that are underfunded. So we have debt service, state issues bonds to build roads and bridges and that's a pretty substantial part of the $30 billion state budget. Public pensions at the state level are underfunded. So that's sort of a credit that the state took that's going to have to be paid back at some point, right? So looking at that picture, declining revenues all of a sudden came out of nowhere that were not anticipated. So now the growth figures have been revised downward to maybe around 2%, maybe a little bit more in terms of growth this year. Folks are waiting for the September figures, and there's a possibility that we'll see mid-year cuts to the budget, which are not unprecedented. The last 10 years has been a recession. We've seen that happen before. And it's in that context that there was not a will in the legislature to raise taxes on the taxpayer to pay for more expenditures. And that reflects the thinking of the governor, and that reflects the thinking of legislative leadership as well. It's a little difference between the legislative leadership in the House and the legislative leadership in the Senate. Now, the one thing that's on the horizon, there's two things on the horizon, right? One is this potential constitutional amendment on the tax on millionaires, on incomes above a million. The other piece that folks are hopeful about, right? But you can't take hope to the bank, is that this downturn that we saw starting in April is a temporary thing, and that we'll continue to see an increase as we go forward, and that a year from now, 2 years from now, we'll be in a much better financial situation. A lot's being done to get control of healthcare costs, some of the biggest pieces of the budget, and so forth. So a long answer to your question, but that tried to paint the bigger statewide financial picture.
So Commissioner, can I just add to that on the Chapter 70? And we've talked about it. I'd like you to hear that. Is I always talk about our Chief Budget Officer, Aldo Petronio, who is here this evening, who went to every one of those hearings throughout the state. I attended one down the Cape and made sure that Brockton's message was out there about low income, about special education student, right, healthcare costs, all of those things that you talked about. Right. And one of the things that I think the state needs to hear, and I'm not sure where this falls, yeah, and this is not disrespectful to my counterparts in the suburbs, but when we have conversations and I hear them talk about their kindergarten classes of 15, we have kindergarten classes of 24 in most of our schools. We had, and I had one of my principals send me an email and said, will the bleeding just stop? In the middle of the summer, our $500,000 grant for kindergarten, which was used to provide a paraprofessional in every classroom, all of a sudden disappeared. We had MCAS academic support that we have used for when we talk about reducing the dropout rate, et cetera. We've had that since, I want to say, 2001, when MCAS first came on the horizon, and all of a sudden that money was gone. So when you talk about equity and we talk about Chapter 70 and all of these things, you know, there is a difference between the urban and the suburban districts, and people need to pay attention to that. You know, I know, again, you work with the Board of Ed, and certainly we will continue to work with our legislative delegation, who are very responsive, but there is a difference.
The interesting point well taken, the interesting thing about the kindergarten grant, this was kind of fascinating to me. So the governor had it in his budget. The way the budget cycle works is the governor presents a budget, House of Representatives presents their budget, Senate goes last, usually around May. Senate usually has the best information to go on. Governor's budget comes out in January. You're projecting out 6 months. The Senate's budget comes out in May. They're only 2 months away from the new year. And then they have to reconcile that. They go through a conference committee. The governor had the kindergarten money in the budget, but targeted to low-income districts. It was a different way of formulating it. It was the legislature that both chambers of the legislature completely zeroed out that funding line.
Mr. Mayor, let me defer to you.
All right.
Out of respect.
All right. Thank you. So I'd like to, Mr. Commissioner, follow up on both Tom and the superintendent's thoughts. You know, I'm really hoping that when you drive home from Brockton tonight, you go home with just a little greater sense and understanding of what the challenges are that we face here in a school district like Brockton, in a gateway city. And I think, to follow Tom's point, we embrace the most highly challenged kids in the state. Those are the kids we're educating. And disproportionately to how most communities educate their children. So I'd just like you to think a little bit about what our schools and our students look like. A little over one-third of our students are English language learners. Those kids are more expensive to educate. About half of our students go home to a household that does not speak English as its first language. We're taking on the challenge of trying to educate kids and help them break the circle of poverty. About over 80% of our students qualify for free or reduced lunch. That means that more than 80% of our kids are living at or below the federal poverty line. And one of the changes that took place this year in DESE's changing of the mechanism in which you determine low-income students from free and reduced lunch to direct certification was discriminatory and penalized a city like Brockton that has a high immigrant population. Because we know not the same percentage of our kids are necessarily being certified in some state-funded program. And that's just, that's part of our demographic. That penalty and that change of the determination of low-income students, that cost us $6 million in our foundation budget. And there was a makeup, but the foundation still went down $6 million. When you show that graph, graph looks great. But this past year, our Chapter 70 local aid for education only went up barely $1 million. Our cost of doing business for level services went up $10 million. But that still doesn't really tell the story, because the Chapter 70 went up $1 million, but at the same time, the formula for calculating the chargebacks for charter school tuitions was changed. That wiped out almost half of it, and the other half was wiped out by the loss of the kindergarten grant. So we really got no real increase in local Chapter 70 aid to education this year, while our expenses went up $10 million, and we had to make painful cuts to our school system. And I also would like you to consider that the special ed kids. Now, we know special education is expensive in every school district, but year in and year out, a city like Brockton's percentage of special ed students is higher than the state average. We're carrying more of that burden. And we also have somewhere between 500 and 600 students in our school system that are classified as homeless. Those kids are traumatized. They've had interruptions in their education. They bring a whole host of special challenges with them. And as Tom said, you know, we embrace them, we love them, but it's costing a lot of money to provide them with the services that they need. And some of these issues I'm talking to you about, these are statewide issues. And Brockton, a gateway city like Brockton, is being asked to carry a disproportionate share of the burden. And I think what really makes it unfair is that a city like Brockton that's facing the most challenges is least able to pay for it. And that's where the disparity comes in. So, you know, the adjustments to the Chapter 70, there are some small adjustments to the Chapter 70 formula that give us a little more credit for some of those students I described to you, but they're not adequate. And your own Chapter 70, or the legislators' Chapter 70 commission said they're not adequate. And as Tom also alluded to, that Chapter 70 commission made a lot of recommendations that would have helped Brockton with our aid to education, but none of those recommendations were adopted. And even something as simple as that October 1st deadline for determining our enrollment, it's discriminatory against a gateway city like Brockton, because we're not Cohasset or Wellesley. People don't move during the summer so they can put their kids in the new school in the fall, and enrollment drops a little each year. We basically have rolling open enrollment. We're taking kids into our school district every day. And between October 1st and the end of this year, we'll probably bring 300 new students in. And it's not just that we won't receive 1 cent of aid to cover their education this year, but because that deadline is so early at October 1st, we won't receive 1 cent of reimbursement for those children next year. It will be the year after next before we see the first dollar of state assistance to educate those children. That's not fair. There's only a handful of gateway cities in this city that you can say that about. The vast majority of school districts are level enrollment or slightly declining. And we were level this year. But if you look back over the last 6 years, we're up 1,800 students in our enrollment in the last 6 years. That's an average increase of 300 students per year. That's almost an elementary school full of students that we're growing by on an annual basis on average over the last 6 years. So, you know, I would just like you to please, as you're working on these issues in the upcoming year, think about fair treatment. Fair treatment of children of poor gateway cities like Brockton. And we won't have the debate right now, but I'll tell you the answer is not a charter school. We already lost $6 million out of this year's budget reimbursing other schools. That's before New Heights starts reaching into our pocket. And so the thought I will just leave you with is, and I think that you and I would agree, this is really the tenet of a public school education, is to provide It's to provide that level playing field. It's to give all kids the same opportunity. Whether they're growing up in Brockton or Cohasset, they're supposed to get the same opportunity, the same education. And the quality of a child's education should not depend on their parents' zip code. And that's what's happening in the state right now. And not only do I say that's not right, the law says it's not right. And we need your help in trying to address some of these inequities that we're facing and trying to keep our school district afloat. So I would just ask you to please, we need your help. We need your help.
Yeah, points well taken, Mr. Mayor. Any concern you may have about whether I understand the circumstances here, remember that I have taken over the two poorest school districts in the state, Lawrence and Holyoke. So we know, and my terms are, we have to do it within the budget that's given to those districts. There's no extra money. There's no extra pot of money that comes with that receivership that we've executed. We've taken over a third one too, Southbridge, right? And so part of what we're hard at work doing is figuring out, can we do better with what we've got? And the first 5 years of evidence in Lawrence, which is the place that we've had the longest track record, is pretty, pretty positive. Probably the poorest, them in Holyoke districts in the state. So all of the challenges of the circumstances that students come from are easily equal in those districts to what you're facing. So I do get this. I absolutely do get this.
We've worked too hard to become Lawrence or Holyoke. And the only thing that's going to prevent us from not becoming Lawrence or Holyoke is being fairly reimbursed for the cost of our kids. And we're doing it here without blowing up union contracts and without wiping out pension plans. And so we're doing it the right way here. We just need it to be treated fairly.
And I want to say, Commissioner, we do not want you coming to Brockton for that reason. We invite you at any other time. And I also want to say, I think it's an opportunity for me to thank the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education for the support we have had. We are a commissioner's district. So we have had support from Eve Bassett today. Joan Tuttle was here. And we're looking at making sure that those level three schools we have, you know, have no chance of becoming a level four school, and every chance of finding ways to improve the child's education. So I will thank you for that support.
Right. So again, just one more point, Mr. Mayor, and you know this, stating what you already know, right? The Department of Education, State Board of Education, Commissioner of Education have no levying authority. We can't make laws, we can't pass budgets. We can recommend. And if you look back, each November, the State Board of Education votes on budget priorities that get sent up to the governor and to the legislature. Each of the last number of years that I've been here, the number one priority has been funding to districts.
Fair enough. Yep, sure. Mr. Minicello and then Ms. Plant.
We recognize the fact that you've been a great partner to the Brockton Public Schools, but we just want to make sure that, you know, again, our issues are conveyed to the powers that be, and we know that you have the ear of the governor and the secretary, and we just respectfully request that you pass that along.
Absolutely. I hear you very clearly.
You know, again, like the mayor said, when I grew up in Brockton, many of us in this room are Brockton graduates, because we're a proud people and we love this city. We just do. I graduated from Brockton High. But one thing you have to understand is that our demographics are changing. This has always been a city of immigrants, and proudly so. But it's getting more and more difficult for this community to absorb the different issues that are coming in, and we just need a partner with the state and with DESE. One quick example, when the Haitian earthquake took place, Brockton saw more kids than Boston. We've got over 200 and something kids. I wrote to Deval Patrick, I wrote to the federal government to say, hey, we need some help here. This isn't a Brockton problem. This is a national problem. This is a state problem. We didn't see a dime, not one dime of support for those kids. And of course, we embraced them. We took them in. They're part of our community. They're, you know, like I said, the longer they're here, we know how to successfully educate these kids. So all we're asking for is for you to convey, you know, the concerns that we have as a community, because we do good work here in Brockton. We don't, like the mayor said, want to become one of these other districts, but it's getting harder for us to maintain. And like I said, the community sees this as the charter school as a chipping away, as making another obstacle for the Brockton Public Schools to have to deal with in order to succeed. And the Brockton Public Schools in this community is seen as the crown jewel of the city. It is such a point of pride. And when people were saying to me in the charter hearings, why are you guys so uptight about this? Why are you so strong about this? Because this is a proud community that loves its school system. It is so much to so many kids. And you know, we basically view our school system as the economic equalizer for these kids. Our kids go to the best of schools. You know, you mentioned about the testing at the state college levels. My kid is at UMass Amherst, doing great. He tells me that there are so many Brockton kids this year at UMass Amherst. He was at the dining hall and he's like, holy mackerel, Dad, you should have seen all these kids. I know them from the high school, so I introduced myself. But what I'm saying is, these kids are so successful. They're in the honors program at UMass. They're down in the honors college at all the different schools. But we just need you to convey, we want to maintain, but we need to deal with these realities of an urban community that we're facing. It's not getting easier for us. Every year, it's getting harder and harder to maintain what we have here in Brockton and to provide for our kids in our district.
Mr. Mayor, Mr. Minicello, message heard. And by the way, I wish I had known. I've started my day yesterday at UMass Amherst campus, so I would have looked for your son there.
Thank you. Commissioner, you said a lot of great things about our school district here, and I thank you for that. I wanted to echo what Mr. Minicello and the mayor said, that we are not comparable to Lawrence. We are not comparable to Holyoke. We're performing miracles in our city. How are we going to close the achievement gaps that we saw on that chart when we have lost funding due to the new formulation of economically disadvantaged, when we've lost we've lost grant money, and our mayor is funding us fully right now? How can we get that achievement gap to close?
Well, first of all, you've got an outstanding, again, through the mayor, you've got an outstanding superintendent who's working very hard on this, and she's got a lot of good ideas that she's putting into play. On regard to the reference to the low-income formula, this comes out of what you accurately labeled as the community eligibility piece that districts have been taking advantage of. There's an upside and a downside to it. The upside is that all students in the district are eligible for free lunch, and what we're seeing in those situations is kids who need that free lunch are getting the free lunch at levels that they weren't previously. It takes away a paperwork burden for the district collecting income eligibility forms and so forth. The challenge is, if you're a district that's done a good job, been diligent about calculating free and reduced lunch, it has a different impact than if you're a district that previously didn't do a good job of calculating that. We're very aware of the ups and downs of this from one community to another. We're working very hard on rectifying that. The legislature gave us until December to come back with a response on how to make that more equitable, and that's something that we're working on as we speak.
Topics just slightly. As I told you earlier, I'm an educator. And presently, there's really only two pathways to become a teacher. You can go through an ed program, through the bachelor's, through a bachelor's program at any of the colleges that offer it, or you can do what I did and get a bachelor's and then take your MTELS and get a preliminary license. But, you know, while I understand that there's a need to set a high bar to have highly qualified teachers, I think we've missed the mark in some places. As a career changer, I started teaching in my 30s, and I felt left out, that there wasn't really a path for people like me. And I looked around my classes, and I saw lots of, you know, young folks. I was 28, 30 when I was doing this, and they all were from mostly the suburban towns in the city. There were very few faces of color, if any at all, in my classes. And as we went through the program, I noticed that there's an inequity there. There's really two pathways. And it kind of, it leaves out people like myself and people who come from backgrounds where it's cost prohibitive to go and take MTELS and pay a couple hundred dollars out of your own pocket. And recently we've been talking about a grow-your-own model here in Brockton so we can diversify our teaching staff. And when I look around at the students that I worked with in the time that I worked here and in the community that I know and the people that I've gone to school with, you know, it's a lot of people aren't choosing to go into education. And a lot of it, I think, has to do with it seems like a huge mountain to climb. And when you do reach out to find resources to become a teacher, there aren't many there. I know at Bridgewater, when I was there, there was a post-baccalaureate program for people who had a bachelor's degree and they wanted to become certified. That program was only offered during the day. So when I went back, I had to make a great sacrifice and take a pay cut and work a job that I, you know, enjoyed thoroughly, but I wasn't allowed to support my family on this income the way that I had been. But it has worked out for me. Not everybody's able to make that sacrifice. So I'm wondering, you know, as we talk about all these different things and how we've done a great job here, one thing that we haven't done is we haven't been able to diversify our teaching staff. And it's hard to do when we're laying people off. And having been in the hiring process in my school, when we look around, we don't see a lot of opportunity there. So what is DESE doing? Are there any plans to offer alternative pathways to certification and licensure?
Yeah, through the chair, Mr. Mayor. There are a number of alternative pathways in the state, and I'm pleased to know that you're thinking about a grow your own pathway. There are several districts that have a similar kind of program. There are teacher residency programs that are alternative pathways that exist in several places. So I encourage you to keep exploring whether or not you can have a homegrown pathway that allows people to come in and be able to earn a living while earning their credential.
I know, I'm very familiar with the ones that Boston has, like BTR, Boston Teacher Residency. We had a program that was run through the state called MINT, probably before you were commissioner. And I know that one of our department heads here at the high school, Mr. McLaren, went through that program, and we gained a lot of really good career change teachers. But that program's gone, and we don't have the resources like the Boston Foundation to fund a BTR or something like that. You know, I think that it would be great for DESE to start to fund these programs again because, you know, I do know of those programs, but it's because I work in the Boston Public Schools and we have the resources to fund those type of programs. Brockton doesn't, Lawrence, Holyoke, they don't either. And, you know, I'm sure there's plenty of people there that are in the community with bachelor's degrees that would love to teach, but they can't, you know, make that sacrifice. So it's something that I would love to see, and I haven't really felt that there is a desire from the state to see that happen.
Through the chair, I encourage you to look at what Lawrence has done. We have greatly diversified the teaching force and increased the number of Lauren residents who are in the teaching force now under the receivership, and I'd encourage you, we'd be happy to connect you with them to see how they've gone about that.
Well, excuse me. I know that there's a great charter school presence in Lawrence, and for whatever reason, charter schools are given more leniency when hiring non-certified teachers. And I think that that would be, I don't know why we're not afforded that luxury. And I do know that, you know, some folks that I'm friends with that have gone to charter schools and been uncertified teachers, we are not really allowed to do that. Well, how does that play into Lawrence's success in achieving that?
Well, the Lawrence teachers are licensed teachers. Mm-hmm. They're certified teachers.
Okay.
They're all members of the Lawrence Teacher Union. Lawrence Teachers Union. They're an AFT affiliate in the case of Lawrence.
Thank you.
Commissioner's already stayed past his time commitment to us, so we're going to have to wrap it up. But I know there are some members of the committee that have not been heard yet. So we'll give everybody a shot, but if you just limit it to 1 or 2 minutes so that we can try to honor our commitment to the commissioner to get him on the road at a reasonable hour. So, Mr. D'Agostino.
All right, I'll try and keep this concise. I am going to just go into the charter issue a little bit, and based on feedback from constituents of mine, like Mr. Confrey, who spoke earlier, and just maybe you can answer some of the questions that I'm getting and help me go back to them with some answers. You know, one of the concerns that's out there, we talk about that there's supposedly wait lists, yet they have a fourth lottery that's coming up next week. So we're still having lotteries to bring students in, but if there are wait lists, why is that necessary, or why would they need to have lotteries? You mentioned earlier that it's not really about needs, so then I'm not sure what the public hearings were about. If it's not to see if there's a want or a need in a district, why did we all go to those public hearings to be heard? Finally, and I'm cutting this way down of what my original comments were going to be on this, if the, you know, a lot of people feel like the team running this charter school has been given a lot of extensions and waivers on things and a lot of autonomy or latitude, I guess. You set some standards that they had to meet by January, all right? Can we expect that you're going to adhere to that and enforce those standards if they are unable to meet them by January? Or, you know, should we expect to see more extensions?
So, through the chair, I'm not sure I'm going to be able to recount all the questions. The first question was about why is there another lottery. So they are currently, as the figure I got today, is 299 students enrolled. They're approved, I want to say, for 315. So they have 6 slots available, and they have a wait list. They have to choose by lottery off that wait list. They can't hand pick which kids they can choose. So that's the reason for the lottery.
That's off the wait list.
Yes.
Okay.
Your second question was the...
what was the point of the public hearings?
Yes.
So
we heard from a lot of people who said, don't do this. We heard from people who said, we want this. And so the state board had to size up the quality of the application we received, the evidence that there was demand, the information we got from the public hearings. The state board takes all of that into account in a very rigorous, deliberate kind of process of looking at that. I bring the recommendation to the state board. State board asks a lot of questions, has a lot of deliberation on this, and I recommended this year for this opening, mm-hmm, that it be chartered. 2 previous years, I recommend that it not be chartered, and the state board supported me on that. Mm-hmm. And your last question was the...
If they don't meet...
Oh, will I stick to the deadlines? I certainly intend to, yeah. I mean, part of what I have to think about in each of these situations, and by the way, it is not unusual for a brand new charter school not to be able to open in its intended facility. We've encountered that numerous times in the history of charter schools. It's not easy to get a building up and running and on time, and it's not unusual to run into things that you didn't anticipate. One of the things that I have to take into consideration is I've got 300 parents, 300 families that are counting on this school. I have a school district that's counting on not having those 300 students. And so I set the January deadline with the thought that if we have to pull the plug on the school, if they can't get it together in Brockton, that at least it comes mid-year where the school district will have enough advance warning to be able to anticipate students coming back in.
And I want to thank all our teachers and administrators here, because as we watched what was happening with the charter school, we weren't sure how many children we would have back. And there were 50 students that came and went. We work with the Department of Elementary and Secondary Ed on what we would do, how we would treat those students. And, you know, we will continue, Mr. Commissioner, in watching this charter, because one thing that I've said publicly is once this charter was given, you know, every child's education is important to me and certainly to our district, no matter where they go to school. They'll be treated respectfully, but we are going to continue our dialogue. It's been a very open dialogue with the DESE. You know, we're watching the funding, we're questioning some of the things, and we'll continue to look at that, you know, because these are our education dollars, you know, going for students in our district.
Commissioner, is there any possibility that you will push for full funding of the McKinney-Vento homeless transportation? There are between 500 to 700 students in the Brockton public school system at any given time.
So we have advocated for McKinney-Vento funding. I'm not sure what you have in mind by full funding, but we certainly have advocated for that.
So last year we probably received half of, I think we received $500,000 that the mayor gave back to the schools, you know, for our transportation. Yeah. So it was quite a cost.
Yeah, through the chair, on the specific issue of homeless students. We're in fact sorting through new requirements from the federal Every Student Succeeds Act in regard to homeless students. So some of the federal ground rules have shifted somewhat that we're still sorting through in that regard.
Questions real quick. You mentioned part of your statement about the Kennedy School here in Brockton.
About the Kennedy School?
Yeah, McDuffie is working there now.
Yes.
It was about 2 years ago that Brockton Public Schools wanted a waiver because they had lost power at that school for one day, and they couldn't get it. The answer was no. So the Brockton Public Schools had to pay all the overtime for those teachers, had to pay for the school buses, without any, no help from the state at all. Yet this charter school applies for a waiver that the building is gonna be moved to a different town, and they're granted. I just can't understand how this whole thing works. If you could enlighten me a little bit.
Your commissioner's been a stickler on 180 days, and I've been very consistent about that during my tenure.
These kids that go 20 to 25 miles to get to school one way?
It was my judgment that the school had put in place transportation, had put in place daycare for students for the two-day late opening, and that they had a suitable facility. So that was my judgment. And we had 300 parents, or 300 students, whose parents want them there.
I'll throw my final piece on the charter dilemma right now. I guess my request as the mayor would be, where is the financial oversight of the money they're spending around facilities? They had one location that you approved in downtown. They spent $250,000 and then walked away from it, left the $250,000 worth of work behind. They went to another location where they were working, building a school where they're going to put 300 children in, with virtually no permits whatsoever, couldn't even come up with a set of architect's plans for wiring, plumbing, sprinklers, alarm systems, et cetera, had the city not stepped in and stopped the work until they got a set of acceptable plans and pulled the proper permits, they were willing to go forward and build a school with taxpayers' money with absolutely no oversight, permitting whatsoever on the work that was being done. I think it really calls into question some of the financial decisions that are being made by this board. I think it calls into question what are the relationships between members of the board and people that they're paying a lot of money to work for them improperly. And so I guess from our standpoint, at the end of the day, those are going to be public tax dollars that come out of our local aid to pay for that school. Where's the oversight as to who's looking over their shoulder to see, and whoever it is, why aren't they doing their job?
We keep very close tabs on the school, up through the opening and now that they're open. They're on a very short leash.
So you were aware that they were doing unlicensed, unpermitted work to build a school?
We rely on the locale, the local district around permitting. We do not permit facilities. We require local building inspectors and fire marshals and so forth for that part of it.
So I guess they didn't know that because they hadn't had any of those folks in while they were building the school. I made my point. I guess everyone's had a chance.
I think I just want to finish up. I think it's really important. The commissioner talked to us, and as a district, this is important. It came up a number of times, is social and emotional learning. And I know this is something that the commissioner is talked about it this summer during the Institute for Superintendents. And I hope, commissioner, when you're looking at the new accountability, that when I look at the work going on in Brockton, trauma-sensitive schools, you yourself with the breakfast in the classroom, I thank you for looking at that first 15 minutes and saying that could be used as time and learning when the students are coming in. District-wide, we have it in every elementary schools. We're working with our middle schools. So I just want to put a pitch in. When we talk about social and emotional learning and you talk about accountability and ratings, this is something we're doing a great job with.
No, I appreciate that. And Mr. Mayor, I appreciate the opportunity to meet with the school committee. Next time, give me some tough questions. giving me all softballs. But I do want you to know that that I've been watching Brockton since I came to the state, literally from the first week on the ground in this state. You've got an awful lot going for you. And particularly your commitment to serving the kids who are on your doorstep. And I understand the challenges and the resources that aren't here that you could be making very good use of. I hear that loudly and clearly. But I thank you for the work you're doing and your staff and you, Superintendent Smith.
Yep. We have something for you before you leave. I know Principal Sharon Wolder, and of course she was very excited about all the accolades for Brockton High and the hard work. So, Principal Wolder. We want to make sure that you remain a boxer.
So you don't forget us and all that we've talked about. And thank you for your knowledge of Brockton.
I love it. Now, I got to see if it's extra large.
Double XL.
We'll get extra large.
That was wishful thinking on your part. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
We thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Very quickly, anyone under new business? Oh no, we have one other piece of business on the agenda. I'm sorry, I took my eye off of it. Under new business, we have the election of the voting delegate for the MASC business meeting. Tom, as vice chair, I'll defer to you on this.
We'll probably accept if that's what the committee wants. I'm going to be attending, so.
So how many, how many people do we have attending?
Who's coming to the
So this is
convention.
The school committee needs to elect one member of the school committee to represent the committee as a whole voting at the first day when they have the, that time?
The conference in Hyannis, votes.
So it requires you making a commitment to have to be there on that first day and attending those meetings.
If someone else would like to do it, that's fine. If not, I'll do it.
Okay. Ms. Sullivan has nominated Mr. Minicello.
Second.
Okay, any other nominations to be made?
So I'm the low man on the totem pole.
Yes. Yeah. All in favor of Mr. Minicello?
No.
Yeah. All right.
So put me down as no.
Mr. Minicello will be our voting delegate at the annual meeting. The MASC does take positions on issues that impact school districts across the state, so it is important for us to have someone there representing the Brockton viewpoint.
It's an excellent conference, and it's going to be about social and emotional learning. That is, again, one of the theme running through many of the conferences in our state.
Okay. Anyone else have anything on a new business as we try to get this wrapped up in a long night? Not to put any pressure on you to not have any new business, but...
I did in the beginning.
I'd just like to add the superintendent's remarks about
Kathy Driscoll Kazanowski. She was my teacher at the Whitman School, and she was probably the first teacher who really got me. I was quite the handful around the same time I had her. I was diagnosed with ADD, and not every teacher that I had really understood that, but she did, and it made a really big impact on me. And she was she's a model for me as an educator, how to be tough, fair, and caring all at the same time. So we reconnected through Facebook when I won this seat, because she had actually served on the Duxbury School Committee. And she was very proud of me. And to receive praise from my teacher, even at the age of 36, was still really good to feel. So she'll be greatly missed. It was really nice to reconnect with her. And she was a great, great woman.
Absolutely. Anyone else? Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, Judy.
I'd just like to say that with the opening of school, grades 1 to 12 in kindergarten, I'd like to thank Superintendent Smith and her executive team for a great start. And it seems like I've met with two parent groups, and I've seen nothing but smiling parents. So it seems like we've
That's
had a good start to the year.
Beats the alternative.
Yeah.
All right, thank you. Anyone else send a new business? All right, how about a motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn, seconded. All in favor? This meeting is adjourned.